Okay, so let's do one. Let's suggest that it was b squared. Let's make it plus 4 x was equal to 0. So we said that k over m, k was 8 and m and the mass was 2 kilograms and we got to 4. So we're going to get the fact that we can use the auxiliary equation m. Remember, this m is usually one we use in differential equation mathematics textbooks, as that's not mass, equals negative 4. In other words, m equals plus or minus the square root of negative 2 squared. So m sub 1, we're going to have two answers there, the positive 1. Now, I can bring that 2 out, so it's going to be positive 2i, and m sub 2 is going to be negative 2i. Apologies there, we had a bit of lighting issues. Electricity is on and off today. This can be written as 0 plus 2i, so we'll have this alpha value being 0 and the beta value being 2. I can now write x of t, which means I can, at any time t, I can know exactly where my mass is going to be if it now oscillates. And that is going to be c sub 1, e to the power alpha, but that's 0. So that is just going to be the cosine of omega t, which is, that is a 2t, plus c sub 2 sine of omega t, which is 2t. So depending on my initial conditions, if I was given at x equals, what, for instance, 0, a certain value and a certain velocity at time equals 0, if I was given two values of that, I could work out what these would be, because I can plug in 0 here, which will give me cosine of 0, which is just 1, so and there be a 0, so I can work out c sub 1. I can take the first derivative of this, which is easy to do, plug in 0, and I can get an answer for c2. So that's how we do it, but usually we don't like to express things like this. We like to express things a bit differently. We like to say that x of t equals a times the cosine of omega t plus 5. That would be the more physical way to do this. And the reason why we do this is because a gives us the amplitude. Now imagine my mass is hanging there again at equilibrium. Leaving it alone, it's hooked on the spring, it hangs there. Now I pull it down a certain extra distance and I just let go. It is now going to oscillate beyond the equilibrium point up, beyond the equilibrium point down, and that is going to be my amplitude. Now imagine I just let it go with the rest. As far as I pulled it below equilibrium, it's going to go above equilibrium. Now, ideal circumstances, we actually call this undamped oscillatory motion. Imagine that there was no resistance in the spring, no air resistance as this move. So it's an idealized circumstance. But what if I pulled it down somewhat and as I let it go, I give it an upward initial velocity? Then if I pulled it down this far, it's not just going to go up that far, it's going to go further, then come down further beyond where I initially let it go. Or if I held it there and threw it down, initial velocity down, it was going to go down, up and down to that point where it turned around, not where I let it go. And this is where C sub 1 and C sub 2 comes in. Because imagine this. Imagine I just looked at it as circular motion. Now, can we put C1 and C sub 1 and C sub 2, these two constants, in here? Can we do this? Yes, we can. If we just imagine the following. If I had pulled it down all the way and let it go, from that, as far as I pulled it down, that was going to be the amplitude. I'm not giving it an initial velocity in any direction, just letting it go from there. It is going, that the extra distance from equilibrium I pulled it down, that is going to be, lo and behold, that is going to be the amplitude. But what if if that was just the starting point at time equals zero, but as I said, I threw it down or I gave it an upward initial velocity, then I'm not starting at this point or that point. Remember, if it's equilibrium there, I can also lift it further up, and then it will go down, up and down, up or down, pull it further down from equilibrium, it will go up and down. Okay, so if I do that, it will really be the imp- amplitude that we're dealing with. But what if I started, and I just imagined it like this, if I started there and gave it some initial, now the radius of the circle, when this gets to the top, that will still be the whole amplitude. But I can certainly determine what that is going to be, because I have here an x value and I have here a y value, and if I use the Pythagorean theorem, I can work out the square root of this plus square root, the square of this plus square of that, and taking the square root of that would give me that, that amplitude. So let's call this amplitude A. And what we can do is this big, make this c sub 1 and this c sub 2. So y equals c sub 1, and let's x equals c sub 2. And if I know these two values here, by virtue of the fact that I have given this problem some initial values, and I can work out what c sub 1 and c sub 2 is, I can work out what the amplitude is very easily. Very easily. And this starting, I can also, where I gave it an initial upward or downward velocity, I can equate to this angle phi. And phi is just going to be the inverse tangent, arctangent of c sub 2 over c sub 1 over c sub 2. C sub 1 over c sub 2. I hope I haven't mixed those two up. But anyway. I can very easily get that. I also note though that, yeah, if I start right at the top or right at the bottom, c sub 2 becomes zero length, and this falls away, and I'll just have this. So if you get an answer from your initial values and you don't find the c sub 2 in there, then you know there wasn't an initial velocity given to it, it was just let go from rest. Okay, so we must just be very careful. Say for instance my c sub 1 value was 2. I'm just imagining c sub 1 was 2 and c sub 2 was negative 2. I'm just imagining. Just be very careful when you do this. Always, when you want that starting angle phi, always be very careful. So c sub 1 is I'm going 2 up, 1, 2 up. Imagine this has a radius of 2. And I'm going negative 2 c sub 1, there's c sub 1, that's y, and c sub 2 I go negative 2, so in this direction. So what I'm trying to say there is what we're starting. So here we have 2 and here we have negative 2, but so this, forget the circle that I drew in, this is now a different problem. I must just remember that the length of this is this absolute value. But what we're working out is this angle phi, but now this is the angle phi. That is the whole angle phi. And this little angle here is pi minus phi. That's pi minus phi. So if I were to take the tangent of this, the tangent of pi minus phi, the tangent of this little angle here is 2 divided by 2, 2 divided by 2, that's just 1. And that's the absolute value, we're just dealing with the length of this and the length of this, okay? And therefore pi minus phi is going to be the arctangent in this tangent of 1. In other words, phi is going to be pi minus the inverse tangent of 1. So just be very careful. Do this in your mind or on paper when you solve these problems, so that you can get the, it's very easy to get the incorrect answer there for phi. And yeah, that's usually how we want to express the answer, because we are seeing oscillatory motion as the spring motion, exactly the same thing. So we've got to tie these two together, and actually, obviously, the math of this works out beautifully.